First at 4, Clinton's concession speech, her message to America, supporters, especially young women and girls. Paula.
Hi, Karen. Very different reactions to the president-elect, and they all seem to have to do with your personal experiences as a citizen in this country.
Rain is out of here for a good long while, but it would be nice if we can keep this around for quite some time. Karen?
Also coming up, Charles Pugh sentenced on sex charges. What he said in court, first at 4.
Live from downtown Detroit, Local 4 News First at 4 starts now.
Hillary Clinton's efforts to shatter the ultimate glass ceiling are trumped by a political stunner.
This is painful, and it will be for a long time.
Donald Trump is moving to the White House. President Obama pledging to ease the transition.
We are now all rooting for his success.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Karen Drew. The reality of a major political upset has been sinking in now for a little more than 12 hours. And last night, Michigan voters were still waiting to see who won our state. Finally, just before noon, all the votes were in. And Trump took Michigan. He beat Hillary Clinton by about 12,000 votes. Clinton did not address supporters overnight, but did speak out just before noon. Kimberly Gill has reaction from Clinton and Donald Trump and President Obama. Kimberly.
Yeah, hi, Karen. Good afternoon to you. What had to be the most painful speech of her life, Hillary Clinton is calling on her supporters to give Donald Trump a chance. The former Democratic presidential nominee called Trump just before 2:30 this morning and conceded the presidential race. That is, of course, after Trump gained the necessary 270 electoral votes. It wasn't until just before noon that she delivered her first public remarks about the defeat. She spoke in New York City, telling her supporters the Constitution requires a peaceful transition.
Donald Trump is going to be our president. We owe him an open mind and the chance to lead. Our constitutional democracy enshrines the peaceful transfer of power. And we don't just respect that, we cherish it.
Now, the president-elect Donald Trump addressed supporters in the wee hours of the morning after receiving that phone call from Hillary Clinton. Trump reached out to people who didn't support him, asking everyone to come together, and President Obama is reaching out to Trump to ease the transfer of power.
We are now all rooting for his success in uniting and leading the country. The peaceful transition of power is one of the hallmarks of our democracy, and over the next few months, we are going to show that to the world.
President-elect Donald Trump has not spoken publicly since delivering his victory speech overnight, but did tweet this morning, quote, "The forgotten man and woman will never be forgotten again. We will all come together as never before." And President Obama has invited Donald Trump to the White House tomorrow. We will, of course, keep you covered. Karen?
All right. Thank you very much, Kimberly. Now, we will have another portion from Clinton's speech a little later in the newscast, plus some of your Facebook reaction. Her speech is the top trending item on our website, and you can go to clickondetroit.com for results in all of the local races that you've been watching. Well, when you look at the election results, you can't just look at the numbers and the electoral votes. You need to look at emotions. Our Paula Tubman found voters on both sides sorting through a variety of feelings this afternoon, including happiness and some fear.
We caught up with Gary doing charity work at Samaritan House in Washington Township today. Economically, he considers himself upper middle class. His concerns are what any reasonable person would consider reasonable concerns.
I'm a professional volunteer after I retired, so I'm real concerned about people. I'm real concerned about the economy. I'm concerned about safety.
Najah also does charity work for Zaman International in Inkster. She would be considered upper middle class as well and has concerns that any reasonable person would consider reasonable concerns.
I have concern about the pulse of the nation.
Yet today is an entirely different day for both. Gary feels hope and optimism because Donald Trump is president-elect.
I voted for the person and not the party.
Najah feels a true sense of concern and dread because Donald Trump is president-elect.
Surprised, stunned.
If these two are so similar, how can they be so many miles apart? Some would argue because one is a white male Catholic and the other is a female visible Muslim. And for that reason, Today is a very different day for both.
I was frustrated about Hillary Clinton's position on right to life, and that's why I voted for Trump.
As a loyal citizen, I'm a constant. My family's been here 125 years. We're five generations deep. So how could he be my president if I'm not his citizen?
If we're bringing in people from countries where we know there's things like ISIS, for example, these people are terrorists.
I think regardless of who comes into this country, the system has to be in place to keep our country safe and secure. We have as much internal threat and violence as we do external threat and violence.
I am afraid of Hillary's position on immigration, and that's why I voted for Trump.
I want to be as valued in a scarf or without a scarf, regardless the color of my skin, because it's my intrinsic right, born and raised in this country, with heritage and with honor.
And so here's the real common ground here. Both of these voters voted their true conscience based on their experience and one real common piece of, I guess you could say, ideology, and that is love of country. But here is more common ground, Karen. Both are very, very hopeful and prayerful for the future of this country. Karen?
All right. I really appreciate that story, Paula. A tale of two reactions, two different people with two very different reactions. Paula Tutman reporting live this afternoon. Our election coverage continues at 5 o'clock this evening. We're looking for answers on why Michigan took so long to finish counting all those votes. Then at 6, a look at the impact of the election on the local Arab American community. And our own Carmen Harlan will share her thoughts on moving forward in a special commentary. That's also at 6, so make sure to stay tuned. In other news this afternoon, former Detroit City Council President Charles Pugh was sentenced today after accepting a plea deal in a shocking sex case. He pled guilty last month to third-degree criminal sexual conduct after engaging in sexually inappropriate behavior with a 14-year-old boy back in 2003. Today, Pugh was sentenced to between 5.5 to 15 years in prison. In court, Pugh apologized to the victim and his family.
I want to start out by apologizing to Austin and his family for violating their trust.
Along with that prison sentence, Pugh will always be required to register as a sex offender. Also in court today, a 21-year-old man from Clinton Township on charges he caused the death of his father and another man. Valen Jukai was driving without a license when he lost control of his vehicle back on October 11th. His 54-year-old father was a passenger in his car and died in that accident. An 83-year-old man was also killed. Today, Jukai was sentenced to a maximum of 15 years in prison for operating a vehicle causing death. Time now for our first look at the forecast, Ben. And obviously lots of people have different opinions on the election, but I think everybody can agree it is pretty darn gorgeous out there today.
It is. You know, temperatures are pretty close to average for this time of year. We're actually going to see those numbers tick upward in the short term, but numbers are going to be all over the map as we get through the 7-day forecast. It's right around 53 in a majority of the area right now. But tonight we are going to see cooler numbers as we head towards morning tomorrow, a warmer finish in the afternoon. But we're going to be back to a freezing start as we start out the weekend. So we'll look at that in your 7-day forecast in just a few minutes. Karen.
Thank you, Ben. First at 4, we're on top of stories making headlines all around the world on this Wednesday afternoon. Let's start in Northern California, where this massive fire erupted at a plastics plant. The bright orange flames lit up the sky in Lodi, California, near the city of Stockton. The fire department had to send all of its 6 engines to the plant, and the city of Stockton also helped out. At one point, residents were told to stay away from the area. The cause is under investigation this afternoon. On the other side of the country, another massive fire, this one in upstate New York. Those flames broke out at the former Bethlehem Steel site. The smoke could be seen for miles. The former steel plant is now a mulching company. So far, no reports of injuries, and the cause of this fire also under investigation. A popular ride in an Australian theme park will never reopen. You might recall 4 people were killed last month on the River Rapids ride. The CEO of Dream World Theme Park says closing the ride is, quote, the only appropriate action following the tragedy. Right now, the entire park is still closed until a full safety review can be done. Ahead, first at 4, credit card security upgrade. Many of you are using and adjusting to those new chip cards, but some of you just can't stand them. New research on who's giving the new cards the worst reviews. Hi, Doc.
Hey, Karen, but up first, who remembers things better, men or women? Well, what the newest research says, and less common symptoms of breast cancer that could help save a life. I'll have those stories next.
Coming up all new on Local 4 News at 5 and 6.
Neighbors heard 2 gunshots, and when they looked out their window, they found a man bleeding in this parking lot. Now Sterling Heights police are investigating the first homicide of the year. Was this isolated, and who are they looking for? Details ahead.
Let's talk good health today. New help for women on how to spot potential breast cancer. Dr. Frank McGeorge is here, and a lot of women focus on searching for lumps.
Right. Well, and that's because it is, in fact, the most common symptom related to breast cancer that leads women to go to doctors. But there are some other indicators that are just as important. In fact, a new study found there were 56 different symptoms. There were some that were more common than others, experienced by more than 2,000 breast cancer patients in the study. Now, among the more common but less often thought of, 7% reported nipple abnormalities, 6% complained of breast pain, and 1% had back pain. And it's really good to be aware of these other potential symptoms because women with the less common symptoms were also less likely to get medical attention.
Okay, I understand you're following a story too where women tend to do better at than something than men. I'm smiling at this because this is going to solve so many conflicts.
Right. This does have the potential to settle some arguments at home. If I could only remember what the study was. No, actually, this research actually specifically shows that men do not have as good a memory as women, and it's based on a new study of more than 200 middle-aged adults. Women did better than men of similar ages on all memory standards, including verbal intelligence and executive function. However, women's memories did begin to decline after menopause as estrogen levels started to fall, which is kind of interesting because, you know, we know that, for example, women often say that when they're pregnant, their memories kind of go awry
that.
And that kind of thing. So there's probably some tie to our hormones and our memory. It's kind of interesting stuff.
It is interesting. But overall, women.
Have,
all right. Just want to reinforce that. Thank you, Doc. All right. Let's go over to Ben Bailey, tracking another cold front. How cold?
Yeah, Karen, it is coming in here. But when we look at the satellite right now, usually when we look at it for cold fronts, they show up with the rain and the clouds that show up along those fronts. But you look out to the west and we've got nothing but clear skies out here. So it does look like our next cold front is going to come through dry. It's still going to drop temperatures, but we'll get there. We've got some warmer numbers to get through first. Right now, pretty close to average for this time in November, which is not something that we have said. Most of this month has been above that mark. North-northwest winds at 10 miles an hour. Pressure is on the high side right now and should stay that way tonight, which is going to keep us in the clear. So as we look at the forecast going forward, lots of sunshine as we get into tomorrow. We'll call it mostly sunny, maybe just a couple clouds out there. But here comes that front, and notice what's not there is any rain along that front. There will be some chilly air behind that. Maybe a few of these lake effect showers coming in off the lake, mainly in our north zone. But generally, most of us are going to stay dry until we get into the middle of next week. Going to notice the difference tonight, though. Four zone forecast is looking at low temperatures when we wake up tomorrow morning, right around 40 degrees in Detroit. Upper 30s here in the northern part of our metro zone. As we look at our south zone, numbers are not going to be all that different as we look at the upper 30s across most of that zone. And then in our west zone, 37 from Flint down to Ann Arbor, maybe a couple 38s there in Novi and Canton. And in our north zone, for low temperatures tonight, we're looking at anywhere between 36, 37, maybe 38 down here in Macomb Township. And numbers not all that warmer against the lakeshore as we head out to the east. So 36 in Lexington, 37 in Port Huron and St. Clair, which is at 37. So high temperatures tomorrow, those are going to be warmer than what we got today. That's back above average. In fact, we'll hit the average mark at noon tomorrow. Notice windy conditions will be out there. Wouldn't be surprised if we get some gusts of up 30 miles an hour. So if there's still some leaves hanging on those trees out there, likely those are going to come down into the yard as we get into the upcoming weekend. And as we head towards Saturday, numbers continue falling in the morning, 31, and that looks like it is going to be an area-wide freeze. Should be the first time we see that number at Detroit Metro Airport this season. Temperatures in the afternoon do start warming up, but not far from average. So once we kind of roller coaster our way back to normal, that's where we're going to stay for the better part of next week. Karen?
Ahead first at four, credit card backlash. Up first, her run for president made history. Now Hillary has a message for young women and little girls. Plus, what you're saying online. We've got our top trending story coming up next, but first, as we go to break, you can take a look at the screen to see how the markets have done today. Obviously, there was some concern last night with the election, but as we see, the Dow has ended up today. We'll be right back. All right, let's talk about our top trending story today, and that is Hillary Clinton's concession speech. She says while she was unable to shatter that highest, hardest glass ceiling, she has a message for young women all across the country.
And to all the little girls who are watching this, never doubt that you are valuable and powerful and deserving of every chance and opportunity in the world to pursue and achieve your own dreams.
Well, we are getting hundreds of comments on the Local 4 Facebook page about Clinton's speech. Tamika writes, great job, Hillary. You ran a great campaign. Please continue to fight for the issues you feel so strongly about. Meantime, Victoria writes, I don't doubt that a good and honest woman will make it someday to the White House. She was not the one. You can join the conversation by logging on to our Local 4 Facebook page. We would love to hear from you. Also today, we've got some bad reviews for those new chip credit cards, but the complaints coming largely from young people. A new survey found most of you prefer the chip readers, but millennials would rather use cards with the traditional magnetic stripes. Millennials say the chip cards are too confusing and they take too long to process. I agree with them. Don't you think it's harder?
It's too long, I will agree with that, but I mean, you look at the difference between taking what? A second and five
seconds. Remember back in the day when they had the ka-chink, chink, and the carbon copy?
You had to write it on the carbon,
Back in the day, nobody even knows what we're talking about, but you're right. That was that. Yeah, it is faster. Okay, still ahead. We're counting down on America's Thanksgiving Parade, and we are getting a reminder of why that event is so important to our community. We're talking about that next.
A Michigan State professor with an unusual university study, the big-time money of pimps working online.
A third of them made over $100,000 a year.
Prostitution is moving off the streets and onto our smartphones, tablets, and laptops, and it's making it tougher for police to investigate.
They became more deceptive in how they advertised. They would change the words that they would use so that law enforcement wouldn't identify what it was they were selling.
School's in session, and this professor says local families have a lot to learn about how pimps lure in young girls and customers. The Defenders, tonight at 11.
So the first time that I met Carmen was actually when I was a teenager. I attended a wedding for my cousin. Carmen babysat my cousins when I was growing up, and one of my cousins was getting married. And I'll never forget seeing her beautiful, this gorgeous hat, this beautiful sundress. She was just so beautiful and poised and classy and just someone that I wanted to be like. So growing up as my role model, Carmen, you have always been someone that I've loved and that I've looked up to, and I wish you all the best in your retirement. Congratulations.
Oh, I saw her in her office today going through scripts. I'm like, Carmen, how are you doing? She's like, it's hard. It really is to say goodbye to a friend, but it is not goodbye.
No.
Because she is going to be a part of our family. She is retiring this week, but she will be back with Devin to host America's Thanksgiving Parade. Gosh, 15 days away.
Unbelievable. Today, the parade company's president was at an event celebrating Detroit's big events. Tony Michaels, there he is, was joined by Detroit Jazz Festival president Chris Collins at the Dearborn Area Chamber of Commerce.
Collins said both events plus the 4th of July fireworks should be celebrated as special occasions that bring together families from our very diverse communities. I guess you could say it's a very timely message as we move on from last night's election and start thinking family, friends, Thanksgiving, and holidays.
We got what, Hobnobble Gobble, a week from Friday.
Have you found your outfit? I still need to shop and find a dress. I'll tell you what color. We're working together that night. All right, thank you so much for joining us for First at 4. We are back at a half hour with Local 4 News at 5. Inside Edition is next. What a beautiful shot.